Thought for the day. As an American, a Muslim, and as a member of a fairly decent family, a commitment should be a commitment. Whatever the provocation, it should not influence you to act in an unbecoming manner. You have to be fair, honest, and direct. If you can't stand the heat, then as Truman said, get out of the kitchen. But your exit should be graceful, decent, and above board. Let others do what they will. You are responsible in the first instance to yourself, your principles and values, and ultimately to Yehovah, Allah. Your loving father.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Both and A Life in Many Worlds by Huma Abedin. Read by the author.
For my parents, Saleha and Zain, who taught me what it means to live fully. For my son, Jordan Zain, who taught me what it means to love unconditionally. Preface. We tell ourselves stories in order to live. Joan Didion. I grew up surrounded by stories. The shelves in my childhood home were filled with books of every genre, every period in history, by every kind of author. Hardcovers, softcovers, brand new, secondhand, spines split from wear and tear. Every bedside table held piles more. By our couch, baskets brimmed with stacks of newspapers and magazines. Then there were the stories passed down by various relatives, as I sat on shag carpets or in family backyards, about generations of my ancestors. The women in my family who defied the norms of their day and pushed against the constraints within which they lived. The men who refused to accept the concept of otherness and explored coexistence during a time when sectarian and nationalistic fervor overtook their worlds. Before me, there came generations of public servants, orators, healers, educators. Their motivations, actions, and choices created the moment I would step into. They blazed trails, which allowed me to walk right on past the barriers they had faced and build a life of my choosing. A life shaped by their pursuit of knowledge, their love of literature, their curiosity about the world, and their commitment to their family, their country, and their faith. When I was a little girl, I believed that my life would somehow be different from the lives of everyone around me. I carried that sense of certitude until a combination of fate, luck, and hard work placed me at the center of an epic adventure. I embarked on a career in public service, inspired by and working alongside an American icon, because I wanted to live the values I was raised with and do justice to the examples set by my parents. I was proud to serve a country that gave my family the freedoms and opportunities they couldn't possibly have had anywhere else. The story that follows tracks the migration of a family over the course of generations, from the Middle East through Central Asia, into the subcontinent of India, over the Atlantic to the United States, back to the Middle East, and then returning again to America. This is not intended to be a treatise on religion, but a personal reflection on the meaning of faith in my own life. It is not a sweeping record of women's rights, but follows the choices, opportunities, and obstacles I encountered and witnessed. It is not an encyclopedic dissection of immigration in America, but just one family's experience of the American dream. It is not a dissertation on American policy in the Middle East or vice versa, but the view of one young woman raised simultaneously in both worlds, loving both, questioning both, and more than anything, appreciating both. It is not meant to be a set of political analyses on any particular campaign or candidate or party, but the chronicle of a singular life in American politics. It is not a romance novel, but there is love, too, deep and true and heartbreaking. My journey has taken me to more than 100 countries, from the desert of Saudi Arabia to the White House in Washington, D.C., from erupting war zones to the shrinking Arctic Circle, from refugee camps to Buckingham Palace, from flying on Air Force One to hiding in car trunks. It is the tale of one person's walk alongside history. Honored to witness, proud to serve, humbled to be recognized, shocked to be dissected, grateful to have been loved, hopeful for the future. This is my story. Part 1. Denial. Happy is the man who avoids hardship, but how fine is the man who is afflicted and shows endurance. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I was a newly arrived American in Saudi Arabia when I got lost in a sea of abayas. It was 1978. I was 3. It was hot that night. Actually, it was always hot. My parents had taken us shopping to Balad to look for curtain rods. Balad is Jeddah's old city, a labyrinth of winding streets leading to a myriad of alleyways where an explosion of sights and sounds meets your senses, emanating from small shops packed closely together. Brightly colored children's clothing, tight bolts of fabric in black and white, endless displays of lamps and dates and perfume, electronics galore with every gadget turned to maximum volume, gleaming jewelry shops with 24-karat gold necklace sets seeming to float in air-conditioned windows. Overhead, fluorescent tube lights made it seem like a perpetual garish daytime. The air carried layered scents of baby formula, musky incense, grilled meat from the shawarma stands, and shisha smoke. Men wore long white thobes with pantaloons peeking out from below, and either white or checkered headdresses. All the women, including my mother, were covered in black abayas. Back then, abayas were loose robes made from black silk or polyester with small armholes on either side and open down the front so one hand was constantly clutching it closed. Draped over the women's heads were black scarves. Some covered their faces entirely, so their world was always a muffled gray. Others had slits cut in the fabric across the eyes to allow them to see more clearly. My mother only settled after haggling on a reasonable price with the salesman, mandatory for shopping in Balad. My older brother Hassan was helping my mother carry one end of the curtain rods, and my big sister Hadil and I were holding on to her abaya as she led us through the confusing, crowded streets toward the car where my father was waiting. We stopped at a shop that sold dates. Before me, at eye level, lay massive round copper trays heaped with different varieties of the dried fruit, all stacked taller than me. Dark, syrupy sweet dates, honey-colored dates that were tougher and chewier, dates dipped in nuts or chocolate. As my mother bent down to sample one, she must have felt the pull of my hand on the back of her abaya. She turned to look at me, and I found her face oddly covered with a veil, which she quickly lifted. I was staring at a stranger. In this mass of identically clad women, I had grabbed the wrong mother. I let go, and she watched me back away, saying nothing. I was overwhelmed by grown-ups towering above, uneven cobblestones under my feet, lines of shops on either side, shopkeepers advertising their wares in sing-song voices. After what felt like forever, straight ahead, through a parting in the crowd, I saw my mother's face. She was screaming my name, and when her eyes locked on me, she ran toward me and grabbed me tight. Her warm tears fell into my hair and down the side of my neck. I have only seen my mother cry during two periods in my life. That was the first time. She quickly ushered us to our father and into our waiting car, and we returned to our temporary apartment. We were visitors here. Kalamazoo, Michigan was home. It was where I was born, where I spent my earliest years, and every summer for years after we had left. There, we took no evening trips to crowded bazaars. We lived in a suburban, ranch-style home with a large picture window, a backyard with a lawn, and a small field of asparagus stalks. We spent weekends shopping at Harding's Friendly Market, picnicking at Millam Park, or driving 2 hours to a kosher butcher in Gary, Indiana, where the proprietor usually mistook our Muslim family for Sephardic Jews. The year I turned one, America turned 200, and that summer was jam-packed with bicentennial celebrations, county fairs, small-town parades, and displays of fireworks, all honoring the triumphant spirit of the red, white, and blue throughout the country, including in our hometown. My brother ran around the neighborhood with kids named Brian, Benji, and Shannon, and my parents went to backyard barbecues with friends. We were surrounded by mostly white people in the middle of white America, and our family felt welcomed with warmth and curiosity. We adapted in ways that made sense to my parents, letting go of cultural traditions that were no longer practical, while holding on to customs and practices that were important to them. Our home was always filled with visitors. According to tradition, my father's mother moved in with us as she aged, so my parents could care for her. There was always a relative coming through town, some just having arrived from India or Pakistan for dinner, a weekend, or a few weeks before they made their own new American homes, or headed back to the motherland after their studies were complete. My parents hosted dinner parties for friends and colleagues, where they would discuss literature, religion, and culture over heaping servings of biryani. They didn't consume or serve pork or alcohol, and no one seemed to mind. Thanksgiving quickly became our family's favorite American holiday. Christmas Eve, we spent at our close friend's house, helping with tree trimming and preparing family feasts, opening the door from time to time to listen to Christmas carols. A few months before my second birthday, my father was diagnosed with progressive renal failure. There were unidentifiable deposits in his kidneys, and his creatinine levels were abnormally high. "Your kidneys are failing," the doctor at the Ascension Borges Hospital in Kalamazoo told him. "At most, you've got 5 to 10 years, so you should probably get your arrangements in order." My father was 46 years old. In response, he simply smiled nodded, and thanked the doctor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.